The following is a special presentation of TFNN. TFNN is proud to welcome back special guest Mr. William O'Neil, founder of Investors Business Daily and Investors.com, for yet another installment of Ask Bill, where Mr. O'Neil takes your calls and questions for the full hour.
Let's go to Jim in New Knoxville, Ohio. Hey, Jim, what's going on today?
Hey, thanks also. I know a lot of people have been thanking you for having Bill O'Neil on again. That was just awesome. Sure is. I love hearing both your brain power together, man. That's really dynamite.
Thank you so much. Appreciate that. Let's go to Al in Apollo Beach. Hey, Al, how you doing?
How you doing? I can't believe I'm talking to two of the three people that are my heroes.
Oh, there you go.
That is fantastic. It is wonderful to be able to talk to Mr. O'Neil.
You got to have courage and don't ever, ever give up.
Yes.
And that's what people need to learn in the market, because you're in the greatest country in the world with the greatest opportunity, the greatest stock to buy, but you got to learn how to handle it.
All right. And it's right in front of our nose, isn't it, Bill?
Yes. It's in front of everybody's nose, and anybody can do it.
I love it.
Now, here's Tom O'Brien with special guest Mr. William O'Neil for this edition of Ask Bill on TFNN.
Welcome, folks. This is Tom O'Brien of TFNN. And today, folks, we have a special guest. And when, you know, the woman from Tampa, she was saying, Hotel California, once you check in, you can't get out. Well, guess what? Once you check in to Investor Business Daily, you don't want to get out. Where were you, folks, when the Dow was 1,252? The S&P 154, NASDAQ 241? Well, our man, Mr. Bill O'Neil, he was starting Investor Business Daily. Want to wish a great happy birthday. 30 years out there doing a great job. William O'Neil, welcome back to TFNN.
Hey, it's about time.
I know. You know what? It's just amazing. We all appreciate you coming back. You know, it's been an amazing run. And you know it is amazing, Bill. You know, all week, you know, of course, you know, I heard CNBC 25 years, and I kept saying, well, 25 years, that's nothing. You've been out here 30 years. But in the context of newspaper, of education, and I'd like to start with this, because we got many questions that we'd like to ask, and we get people on the line. When you started this, right, what was the urge and the passion to start it?
To start what are you talking about?
To start Investor Business Daily.
Well, I'd been in the market for years, and we'd had all kinds of research, and we had a lot of big institutional clients from Fidelity right on down the line.
Yes.
And we felt that this information ought to be given out to the public, because the market's not that easy, you know?
Yes. You know, it's amazing. When I look at your history, and this is so cool, folks, because back in 1984, we didn't, computers were just starting. I mean, IBM had all of, what, a 286 out there. But what folks may or may not know, you actually used technology very early on, and that's why that you had all that data, right?
Yes, we had a database on all the stocks, and we've always used that.
You know, we have the first question is from an engineer, Bill, from Kansas City. And this is, Bill, I have two questions. Well, and I've always wondered about this. I've been a subscriber to IBD for 10 years. I have these questions. I think others may have them as well. In past interviews, you've talked about this bull market cycle that, you know, we may have entered or that we have been in since March of 2009. And what his question is specifically is that, has this bull market ended, and or are we in another bull market? So from 2009 to where we are now, where do you think we are in the market? I know, he's killing you, right?
If you go through a correction of 15-20% and it corrected for 6-9 months or so, I look at that almost as a mini bear market, and then you start a whole new cycle. So I think that we did start some new cycles, and they probably go back to January of 12.
Yes.
And so we're in starting a third year. And usually in the third year, you don't make as much progress as you made in the first two.
And if we look at, you know, you explain really well inside the newspaper, inside your books, how to make money in stocks, that you're always looking for what is new in order to basically have big expansions in the marketplace. And there's a question here, and it's such a cool question, because when Amy Smith, your tigress from IBD, comes on every Monday, right?
Yeah.
It's so cool, Bill, because she is so great. And she was bringing up, and it's pretty amazing, you know, inside this correction that we had, you have these energy stocks that are doing business in the Midwest that absolutely refuse to go down. So when we talk about the new oil that we have in the Midwest, do you think that that, in fact, is like a, not a new technology, but a new source of energy going forward?
Probably so, but also oil stocks are looked at as a little bit safer to some extent. They're not quite as wild as a high-tech stock.
I see. Okay. Yeah, that's great to know. So inside the context of corrections, that's a good place for folks to hide, right?
Well, it's a little safer.
Okay.
The only place to really hide if you get into a correction is cash.
Yes. And when you take the aspect, what would be the advice that you'd give people? I know you hammer this home that, you know, you have 8%, get out of the stock. I guess where my question comes from is this. There has been plenty of small, mini corrections, let's say, because last year was such a big year. And it seems that sometimes folks get rewarded for not getting out. Do you know what I'm saying? So
yes.
How, you know, can you bring across to folks that, hey, listen, protect your capital?
Well, I think if the market sells off 3, 4, 5%, that's not a very big correction. But if you're 7 or 8%, you're starting to get into territory where you're being affected a lot. So
yes.
I wouldn't say selling back a lot if you're down 3 or 4%. But at some point, now the ideal way that I like to apply things is if I'm up 15% or more, I'm going to take some gains just because I'm up 15% or more.
Yeah, that's great.
And so you learn to take some things down while they're still advancing and they're still up there. Because a lot of times, if you don't do that, they'll go up 15 and come right back down.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing, actually, when you look at the market, that how many times your account can go red from green, right?
That's right.
If you don't take the money.
Yep.
We have a question here from Logan Moss. And the question is, I only buy stocks that meet all CAN-SLIM requirements. I look for quality earnings that are up 25, three-year growth rate 25, new factor accumulation distribution rating C plus or higher, top five in at least one category providing by stock checkup and increased fund ownership. Do you think these are accurate and good measures to evaluate a stock? And what should I do when the three-year growth rate says NA in the stock checkup?
Well, check to make sure that you don't actually have a percent for that three-year period. If they say NA, if they were in business for 3 years, well, what was that? Were the earnings flat for the period, or were they down, or were they up? So I don't know exactly what an NA might always tell you, but just double-check it. But I like to have something that's proven in the past. It's got some growth, as well as right now the earnings are up in the last few quarters.
And when we'll, you know, I'd like to talk a little bit about, I think, you know, if I've learned anything off you through the years, that companies that are going to go an extended run, it's a new company of an IPO within 3 or 4 years, right? And
yeah.
Inside a new area, not a new sector, but they have something new, right?
Yeah, you don't need somebody that's copying what everybody else has had for a long time.
Yes.
It's a new product, a new service, and it's selling. So the sales and earnings both are moving up and acting well.
And in the environment that, you know, we've been in, I guess when I look at many companies out there, there's a lot of good ideas right now. You know, I'm not saying that, you know, I know we're at highs, but it seems that even the last couple of years, because either there's more cash out there or there's more ideas out there, It's going to be intriguing to see, well, there's technology that are in a lot more business, like how much technology is used in the oil and energy business right now.
Well, you have new products and new services all the time. And I think the simple way to judge these is they must have earnings and sales increasing a certain amount. Now, I want to see them up 15-20% or more. And by the way, I think when a stock advances, at some point you should start nailing some things down. So if a stock is up 15 or 20%, I think you want to cut back on it a little bit. In other words, you nail it down while it's there, because sometimes it goes up and comes right back down.
Yes. You just stay right there for a second, Bill. It's a short break. Folks, come over to our website at TFNN. You're going to see the IBD banner on the right side. You can hit that banner. Bill's going to be doing a webinar. It's going to be on the 24th. It's a complimentary webinar.
Has the current market volatility continued to stop you out of trades when the market spikes against you? Now is the perfect time to open up an account with Nadex. Nadex, the North American Derivatives Exchange, is a brand new, completely regulated Chicago-based exchange, and unlike most other exchanges, Nadex allows you to trade directly through them with direct market access when using their completely free trading platform, which also features real-time charts and full customization capability. One of the advantages of trading with Nadex in volatile markets is that your risk is always capped, and you have the ability of keeping your trades open even when the market spikes against you. Nadex is completely brand new with a line of unique trading products that are unavailable anywhere else. See how it works at nadex.com. That's nadex.com. Or click on the Nadex banner on the front page of tfnn.com. Futures and options trading involves risk and may not be appropriate for all investors.
No matter where you listen to TFNN programming, we want you to know you can always access your favorite shows on demand through TFNN.com. TFNN airs live programming every market day from 9 a.m. till 6 p.m. Eastern, and you can view each program by accessing Tiger TV through our homepage. We even have an easy link for all mobile devices, including iPhones and iPads, located at the top right-hand corner of the TFNN homepage. You can use your smartphone to view Tiger TV. If you don't have a mobile connection that can keep up with streaming live video, then you can simply visit tfnn.mob in the browser of your smartphone for live streaming audio of all of our programs. The mission of TFNN is to educate our audience directly and interactively through our interactive website and radio call-in talk shows. TFNN is able to teach all levels of investors the technical skills needed to trade in today's marketplace. In order to get the best information possible, TFNN has assembled the most respected financial minds in the country to provide the most current news and comprehensive advice available. TFNN.com, educating investors.
You take a hands-on approach to managing your investments, and whether you're bullish or bearish on U.S. Treasuries, the ETFs from Direction Shares are there to help you magnify your perspective. Bull ETFs for a rising market and bear ETFs for a falling market. Direction Shares gives you the tools for both sides of the trade. Discover how we can help at directionshares.com today. An investor should consider the investment objectives, risks, charges, and expenses of the Direction Shares carefully before investing. The prospectus and summary prospectus contain this and other information about Direction Shares. To obtain a prospectus or summary prospectus, please contact Direction Shares at 800-851-0511. The prospectus or summary prospectus should be read carefully before investing. An investment in the funds is subject to risk, including the possible loss of principal. The funds are designed to be utilized only by sophisticated investors, such as traders and active investors employing dynamic strategies. Investors in the fund should understand the consequences of seeking daily investment results, understand the risk of shorting, and intend to actively monitor and manage their investments. Distributor, Foreside Fund Services, LLC.
Tom, take your phone calls now. Toll free at 1-877-927-6648. Internationally at 727-445-1044.
Welcome back, folks. We have our man, Mr. William O'Neil. We're celebrating Investor Business Daily's 30th anniversary, 1984, April of 1984. Bill will take your phone calls. Our phone number is 877-927-6648. And as you do come over to our website at TFNN, folks, you're going to see the banner on the right-hand side, investors.com. Now, when you hit that banner, Bill's going to be doing a webinar. It's a complimentary webinar celebrating the 30th anniversary of Investor Business Daily. That is going to be on April 24th, and it's going to be all about past, present, and future market leaders. You know, Bill, when we talk market leaders, what are we looking for when we're looking at a market leader?
Well, first of all, it's got to be performing, not that somebody thinks it's going to perform. So it should be acting a little bit better than the market in the last several months.
Yes.
So look at the earnings percent increase. The bigger, the better. And the sales also should be increasing. Those are two basics that you start with.
And, you know, with that, it's really cool because we got questions from all over the world. This one is from Stephen Cutnery in England. I use company earnings section of IBD to get an idea of the underlying health of the market. I record the number of up earnings and down earnings and compare the ratio to the prior quarter. IBD reports earnings better than any other source I know. Do you have any plans to maybe expand that coverage to foreign-based companies?
I don't know that we are planning to expand that to foreign companies. I like to think that there are thousands of companies over in this country, and some of them have foreign divisions.
Sure.
But what do I know about a lot of foreign stocks? Japanese stocks or Chinese stocks or
yeah.
French stocks? I think it's complicated enough. I want to keep it kind of simple.
I love it. And you know what, Bill? You know what's amazing? I get asked the question so many times. It's amazing to me that people continually, you know, our dollar, okay? They continually think that the dollar is going to go down to zero. And it's amazing to me because when I look at that and say, okay, well, where else are you going to go? It's like, when you're sitting in the middle of this beautiful country, and you know, I do understand that, yeah, the dollar's come down, but the dollar looks to me like it bottomed in 2008.
Well, where else are you going to go? Are you going to put it in France or Portugal or what? I think.
Seriously, that, I know. There's no doubt. There's no doubt.
Yes.
We have a question from Rocco in New Jersey. Hey, Rocco, you got a question for Bill?
I do. Hi, Mr. O'Neil. I'm wondering if with the recent lagging of the NASDAQ and oil and some steel stocks starting to surge, if this period reminds you of 2006 when that also occurred and what you think it portends.
Well, I'm not sure whether it's exactly like 2006. But oil is one thing. I think steel is a very... did you mention steel?
Yes.
Yeah, that seems to me like that's a very cyclical situation. I think oil is a little more stable. I don't tend to buy stocks based on an industry. I look for a company that's unique and the earnings are accelerating and they're up a fair amount and the sales are really there. And then the stock has to be acting right. And I use charts and try to determine, is this stock really acting better as it should with those kind of earnings and all. So I will use charts plus earnings and sales.
Thank you.
Rocco, thank you so much for the question. Really appreciate it. You know, that was an intriguing question, Bill, because I had gone back and I was looking at some of your quotes. And there was a great quote from you in 2008. And what it was this. And this was right at the highs of the market. And this was, you were getting interviewed by, it was a Fidelity guy or someone else. I just forget who was interviewed. But what you said specifically was this. You said that, listen, people should have their own system, look at the technicals, look at the fundamentals, and happy with the system that they're looking at, right? That they're trading with.
Yeah.
You know, so in that context, that was timely in the aspect because the euphoria was there, no doubt, right?
Yes, and you have to look at how long has the market been going up and how far some of these stocks, like we are now starting into the third year of recovery, and typically most of your money is made in the first and second year. So just be aware of how far down the line are you and watch your stocks carefully. And I think a decent plan is to sell on the way up when you're ahead a little bit. Now, if I'm up 15% on a stock or 20% on a stock, I think I'm going to want to sell it.
Yes.
While it's up there.
And why don't you think, listen, I absolutely agree with you, and I'm trying to figure out whether that has to do with longevity in the marketplace. Well, it definitely has to do with longevity in the marketplace, because if you don't sell, you don't have any money left, right? That's one part of it. Sometimes I think, is that why don't people take their money? You know.
Well, when it's up, they think it's going to go higher.
Yeah, exactly.
So you have to buy something that's right, and if it works and it's up 15 or 20%, I say sell it. Now, on the other side, you're going to make mistakes no matter how smart you are.
Sure.
And you want to cut those short. So I don't want my losses to be 15 or 20%.
Right.
I want to cut them when they're down 3, 4, 5, 6, 7%. So my average loss when I'm wrong should hopefully be 4 or 5%, and my average gain when I'm right ought to be 15 or 20%.
Yeah, and it's that clean. I mean,
yes.
It's that clean.
But if you sit there and you're down and you're waiting for it to come back, well, you're taking big risk because maybe it goes further and further down.
Sure. This is, I think, a great question. This is from Dan Bartlett in L.A. And what his question is how do you choose between two stocks in the same industry that have very similar fundamentals and technicals when you don't have as much in your portfolio as you'd like? And the example he brought up were two pharmaceuticals, VRX and SLXP, which were, you know, two nice high-flying stocks that went up. So should he just divvy, you know, do 50-50? And how would you look at that?
What was the last symbol?
The first one was VRX, which is Valiant Pharmaceuticals. And the second one was SLXP, which is Salix Pharmaceuticals. That high was 120, the low is 47. And they both seem to, if I look at the SXLP, that was an equity that went from $9 up to 120, like maybe only one or two corrections in it. Oh, that was from 2009 to basically 2 months ago. And VRX looks like it went, these were incredible runs, actually. Yeah, VRX had one correction in the course. That was a stock that went from $13 to up to $160.
Well, I like to buy the stocks that show the biggest increase in earnings and sales, and that they also are acting much better than the market. Now, you've got to be careful when you're buying, because, say, VRX, it broke out of a base. If you were buying it at 115 when it broke out of that base,
yes,
you would have been okay. If you were buying it in January, you would have wound up losing money because it went up a little bit and then rolled over and tanked.
Sure.
So this says to me that you better learn how to read charts, because on the VRX, it had a perfect base all during the last quarter of the year. It broke out and ran in 1 week a huge amount, and anything after that, on that first week, you're chasing it, and you get killed when it corrected.
And that's huge what Bill just brought up, folks, because there's no doubt when you look at the canned slump system, it's what, you know, base are you breaking out of? As you go over to investors.com, folks, there's some great sessions that are coming up. You get beginning strategies, you get intermediate strategies, you get advanced strategies. Cleveland, Ohio, Minnetonka, Minnesota, Wheeling, Illinois, that's April and May. Arlington, Virginia, Wheeling, Seattle, that's May, June. Bill and Neil and I are going to be right back, folks.
You've always taken the long view when it comes to investing, but what if there's an opportunity right under your nose? What if you could be more responsive to market trends to seek to boost your portfolio performance right now while seeking to reduce your overall risk? At Direction Funds, we connect investors with alternative strategies that seek to maximize their returns. Smart investors deserve smart alternatives. Find yours at directionfunds.com. An investor should consider the investment objectives, risk, charges, and expenses of Direction Funds carefully before investing. The prospectus and summary prospectus contain this and other information about Direction Funds. To obtain a prospectus or summary prospectus, please contact the Direction Funds at 800-851-0511. The prospectus or summary prospectus should be read carefully before investing. Investing in index funds may be more volatile than investing in broadly diversified funds. Distributed by Rafferty Capital Markets, LLC.
Tom O'Brien's weekly gold letter, The Gold Report, gives complete and concise coverage of the entire gold market. Inside, you'll get Tom's commentary on gold, the dollar, the rand, the bond, the XAU, the HUI, and detailed coverage of nearly 25 mining stocks. He'll give you the entry price, price target, and stop price of each stock trade. The Gold Report is a long-term newsletter where the focus is on building real wealth through the management of a successful portfolio of gold stocks. With a lifetime of knowledge and almost 12 years of writing his informative weekly newsletter, The Gold Report, Tom O'Brien can provide you with the important market information to help you make better trades in the gold market. Don't let the next bull run in gold pass you by. To get a month-long free trial to The Gold Report, an $85 value, visit the front page of TFNN.com today.
In quiet markets, investors search for new trading opportunities. We'd like to introduce you to a new product that provides opportunities even in flat markets. Nadex, the North American Derivatives Exchange, is a new and innovative Chicago-based exchange registered with the Commodity Futures Trading Commission. And unlike most other exchanges, Nadex allows you to trade directly through them with direct market access when using their trading platform. Nadex never charges a fee to use their platform, which even includes real-time charts and full custom capability. Nadex's unique short-term binary options allow traders and investors to capitalize on strategies even when the underlying markets are quiet. Nadex's innovation has allowed them to come up with a line of unique trading products that are unavailable anywhere else. See how it works at Nadex.com. That's Nadex.com, or click on the Nadex banner on the front page of TFNN.com. Futures and options trading involves risk and may not be appropriate for all investors.
This segment is brought to you by Think or Swim. For more information, just click the Think or Swim banner on the front page of TFNN.com.
Welcome back, folks. We're celebrating Investor Business Daily 30th anniversary with the founder, Mr. William O'Neil. And as Thomas Edison would say, many of life's failures are people who did not realize how close they were to success when they gave up. You know, that quote, Bill, I guess if people came over and got their head wrapped around charts a bit, would help them dramatically inside the context of investing, wouldn't it?
Yes, and you have to have a specific buy and sell plan. In other words, you can't just buy something because I like this stock and I think it's going up. In other words,
yes,
where are you going to sell it? So I would say something like, if it's up 15 or 20%, I would sell stocks. And if they're down and I'm losing money, I would cut them at 5 or 6%.
You know, we have a great question from Bob Perry in Boston. And what it is, he met you, this is pretty amazing too, folks. You talk about longevity. He met you in the 1970s at MIT. And if you didn't know this, folks, you know, IBD has meetups all across the United States, and they still have a meetup at MIT, okay? And so it's amazing because this guy is still at the meetup, Bill, in MIT. And what his question is this, is that he was wondering if in the course of, you know, from the 70s to now, have you modified or changed the original system that you had?
I don't think it's changed too much at all, because there are just certain basics. And one is, you cut all losses and possible mistakes quickly.
Yes.
You don't want to lose more than 2, 3, 4, 5, 6%. And on the other side, you better nail down a few when they're up 15 or 20. So we use charts, but we never buy something because of a chart. We'll buy it because it's got big accelerating earnings and sales, and we know the story, and the chart also looks right.
That's beautiful. Let's go to Mahoon in Orlando, Florida. Mahoon, you have a question for Bill?
Yes. I wanted to ask Bill that I'm 40 year old, and I want to know, like, is there any place for dividend paying stocks in my portfolio, or should I just concentrate on growth stocks?
I don't think there's anything wrong with limiting your choices to stocks that pay a dividend. I would not buy a stock solely because of the dividend, and I certainly wouldn't buy the highest dividends. If you get 6, 7, 8% yield, there's something that's a question. So just be careful. Mainly stocks will go up because of the increase in the earnings and the sales, And if they don't go up and they go down, you got to cut the loss quick before it can hurt you.
Mahoon,
okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. We really appreciate the question. Bill, we have a question from Bill Scott in Scottsdale, Arizona. And what the question was is, what was the hardest thing you had to deal with in running the newspaper? And by the way, thanks so much for doing a great job with Investor Business Daily each and every day.
Well, the paper lost money for the first year or two. It wasn't that difficult for us because we were dedicated and motivated and we were going to make it work. It's now profitable and doing very well. But you can't just start a national newspaper and expect it to be profitable the first week.
Sure, sure. And, you know, in the course of the last 30 years, what changes have you seen that have been good for the market and are bad for the market?
Well, I don't really. There's change going on all the time, but I don't think the things that are basic really change much. The company has to have a better product, and it's selling, and it shows in the sales, and then the earnings have to be there, and then the price action has to be there. So the game is not really any different it was 30 years ago, and I was there 30 years ago, and I always cut losses. I didn't want to sit with something because it was down. I was losing money, and I would hope it would come back.
Yes.
So the rules are cut the losses short so they don't hurt you no matter what, and nail some down when you have a worthwhile gain.
You know,
and buy things with big earnings increases.
Yeah, and as we're talking here, there's no doubt that when we wrap up what you're saying, the market is more simple than folks make it out to be, right?
Well, the basics, yeah, they don't change.
Yeah,
either
right.
The earnings are up or they're not.
And that's it. That end of story. No, forget the stories inside what all the CEOs or the press or anyone else would come out there. You're either accelerating earnings, you're not accelerating earnings, or you're losing money.
That's it.
We have another question, and this has to do with, there's no doubt in the last 30 years, we've had a huge amount of baby boomers, huge amount of 401ks, and it seems that what the question specifically is that many of these 401ks, they only can be in mutual funds. So what this guy's question is that, is this something that I should stay invested in? Is this something that I should get out of when there's large corrections? Or how should I handle that? And he has two different parts of the question, Bill. One is that, you know, he's younger right now, but when he gets a little bit older, in 4 or 5 years away from retirement, how should he handle that? If he only can be in mutual funds inside his 401k?
Well, I think when you're younger, you should be buying growth. Now, once you get to be 60 or more, if you really know what you're doing, there's still nothing wrong with that. But I think you want to then move toward the dividend stocks and the stability and safety and all of that. But I think it also comes down to you'd better study and learn the market so you know what you're doing and you're buying the best stocks and you know how to, when should you be selling stocks. You know, it's not easy, and you have to spend some time working at it. You just can't buy a bunch of stocks and think everything's going to be okay.
Sure. And when you I hear you loud and clear, meaning that you have the expansion of sales, you have the expansion of earnings, which earnings no doubt are crucial. And when we're looking at new IPOs, can you talk a little bit about, because there's many listeners out here, and you know, I know by reading your books that when you have a new IPO, it seems like, a couple years after the new IPO, the bottom line is that some of those equities have the biggest chance to make their biggest expansion. Would that be correct?
Well, I think an IPO, as long as the earnings are up and the sales are up, is a good area to look in because you got younger, newer growth situations normally.
Okay.
But the earnings must be up and the sales, and then the price should be acting reasonably well.
Yeah, that's so cool because there's nothing like being basically a robot in the marketplace, right?
Yes, the rules are pretty simple. Who's got the biggest earnings and sales, and is the general market okay, and you're buying stocks that are moving up, and you're cutting losses on the ones that you're wrong on at a very quick pace so that you don't get yourself hurt. You don't sit with things that you're losing money on and just hoping they're going to get better.
And, you know, in the context of cash in your pocket, you know, and this is an aspect that it seems to me that inside the financial business in general, that the propaganda is on a continual basis, you should always be in the marketplace. You know, and when I look at that, I say to myself, you know what? I mean,
that's wrong.
Exactly. Okay, so can you talk about that a little? Because realistically, I know, you are, a huge influence inside the marketplace. But when you look at the large, whether it's the newspapers, the large TV stations, you are the only one out there, and I am being prejudiced, folks, okay, but I'm being real. You're the only one out there that will turn around and say, hey, you got to sell and get into cash. So in that context, can you talk about that a little?
Well, for example, right now for the year, I'm up 13.5%. Now, that's okay. It's not tremendous, but I'm only 25% invested in the market. And you don't have to be fully invested all the time. You're invested when you're making money and you've got to sell and nail some stocks down. If I have a stock that goes up 15 or 20%, I may be selling it, and all of a sudden I'm not fully invested. I'm only 50% invested, but I've nailed down some gains as I'm going. So it doesn't do you any good to buy something that goes up if you don't sell it at some point, because it may come right back down and just had a nice little merry-go-round ride.
Sure. Yeah, and it seems that I guess one of the saddest things I've, and you've probably seen it many times too, continually inside the marketplace, is that they'll hold on forever. And, you know, when we take a look at the markets going back, and it seems like this is forever. Just as you said, well, like when you figured out these rules for CanSlim, I mean, you can go back to the, I've only gone back to maybe the 30s, you know, early 20s or something. But markets never go up forever and never go down forever.
That's right. Mm. So you want to buy stocks when they're moving up and you want to sell and nail them down. You can't just sit and say, well, I'm a long-term investor, and they go up and they come all the way back down. In a bear market, or when a stock that is a leader tops, its average correction is 75%. Now, just think about this for a second. If you had 100 index and that index dropped to 25, for you to get back even, you have to go from 25 to 50 to 75 to 100. You have to have a 400% advance. And who can do that? So you can't let a stock go down a lot.
Now,
you have
folks,
to cut losses short and then nail down some gains if they're up 15, 20% or more.
Now, folks, remember something. This program's going to be archived. You can play the Bill's last statement over and over and over again. And the key to remember is this. The best stocks can get down 75%. That's an amazing amount, Bill. When you know there's still a good company, but a good company has nothing to do with a bear market and a stock going down, right?
That's right. When a leader finally tops, the average correction is 75%.
That's amazing.
So it's dangerous out there if you're just going to say, oh, well, this is a good stock. I know I'm okay. It'll come back. You don't play that way.
You don't play that way. No, there's no doubt. The thing, you know, it's so cool. Listen, folks, you stay right there. We get a quick break. But, folks, go to TFNN. On the right-hand side, you're going to see investors.com banner. Hit that banner. Bill's going to be doing an outstanding webinar. It's free. It's a complimentary webinar celebrating 30 years of Investor Business Daily. It's going to be on April 24th. When you hit the banner at TFNN, you're going to go right to investors.com, the front page. And it's right there, and you're going to see April 24th. It's 1:30 p.m. Pacific time. It's 4:30 p.m. Eastern time. And what it's going to be all about is past, present, and future market leaders. You're listening to our man, Mr. William O'Neil. And if you're listening closely, folks, the market, number one, is much, I'm not going to say easy, but the clarity is there. It's earnings, it's growth, it's firepower inside those earnings. Bill and I are going to be coming right back, folks. You stay right there.
Has the current market volatility continued to stop you out of trades when the market spikes against you? Now is the perfect time to open up an account with Nadex. Nadex, the North American Derivatives Exchange, is a brand new, completely regulated Chicago-based exchange, and unlike most other exchanges, Nadex allows you to trade directly through them with direct market access when using their completely free trading platform, which also features real-time charts and full customization capability. One of the advantages of trading with Nadex in volatile markets is that your risk is always capped and you have the ability of keeping your trades open even when the market spikes against you. Nadex is completely brand new with a line of unique trading products that are unavailable anywhere else. See how it works at nadex.com. That's nadex.com. Or click on the Nadex banner on the front page of tfnn.com. Futures and options trading involves risk and may not be appropriate for all investors.
Who says you can't take it with you? TFNN says you can. With your mobile device and TFNN's live radio streams, TFNN has put it all in the palm of your hands. No special apps to download. No subscription fees for live radio or Tiger TV streams. We say you can.
Now let's go over to the dollar, because the dollar is going to be the generator. It is the generator of basically higher dollar, lower market. And what the dollar has done, and this whole uptrend, folks, has just gone sideways. The way it works, folks, is this.
We say you can. The Tiger Financial News Network. Smart investors and professional traders know you can. TFNN.com. Educating investors.
You take a hands-on approach to managing your investment strategy. You're always looking for the next trading opportunity to magnify your perspective. Direction Shares connects sophisticated traders with a powerful array of ETFs from a wide range of asset classes. The markets may go up and down, and you want tools for both sides of the trade. Discover how we can help at directionshares.com today. An investor should consider the investment objectives, risks, charges, and expenses of the Direction Shares carefully before investing. The prospectus and summary prospectus contain this and other information about Direction Shares. To obtain a prospectus or summary prospectus, please contact Direction Shares at 800-851-0511. The prospectus or summary prospectus should be read carefully before investing. An investment in the funds is subject to risk, including the possible loss of principal. The funds are designed to be utilized only by sophisticated investors, such as traders and active investors employing dynamic strategies. Investors in the funds should understand the consequences of seeking daily investment results, understand the risk of shorting, and intend to actively monitor and manage their investments. Distributor, Foreside Fund Services, LLC.
This segment is brought to you by Think or Swim. For more information, just click the Think or Swim banner on the front page of TFNN.com.
Welcome back, folks. Our guest is Mr. William O'Neil. We're celebrating Investor Business Daily 30th anniversary, April 1984, folks. And in April of 1984, which is a beautiful thing, the Dow is at 1,252, the S&P at 154, and the NASDAQ at 241. It's been quite a run, hasn't it, Bill?
This country is the most successful in the whole world. So typically, you'll have two or three years that are very positive, and 1 year will come off. Then you start to cycle all over again. So it continues to grow.
Yeah. And, you know, it is amazing, to me in this day and age, it seems that over the course of so many years, people will turn around and say, oh, this country, well, Europe's going to be better, South America's going to be better, Asia's going to be better. And I look and I say to myself, you know, why? Okay. And because when we look around the world right now, it's just amazing. Like, you want to go to Europe? I don't think so. You want to go to South America? They'll take all your money. You want to go to Russia? Forget it. You know, Putin's going to take everything. And Asia, I mean, is growing. There's no doubt. But, you know, there seems to be a disconnect at certain times, Bill. And what do you think that disconnect is?
Well, people always are looking for a different place, a newer place. You're in the best place. We have freedom, and you can do anything you want, and you just have to gain experience and use your head, but you don't need some other country.
Yes.
This is the best place, and it has some tremendous investments, and learn how to handle them well.
Yes. We have a question from Noel in Oklahoma, and what his question is that what are some of the market clues that we may be at a market top?
The best clue is how the market itself acts. Now, it is true we're starting the third year of recovery, and then most of your money is usually made in the first or second year.
I see.
So it'll probably be a little tougher sledding this year, but you just have to watch the market itself and watch some of the key leaders. When the market really tops, the leaders are going to come down, and when they come down a lot longer than people think.
Yes, and in that context, that we have another question here, and that's what this is about, and it's timely because it's about the market, how it acted Tuesday, and of course that was only 2 days ago, and what this is Eve from Los Angeles, and her question is: Tuesday reversal appears to be the start of a potential rally. Would you buy on such a strong reversal day? With growth names so beaten down, would you buy the best fundamental growth names as they begin to show strong price volume action? Or would you wait for basis to form, which may take 2, 3, or 4 weeks?
Well, I don't like to buy stocks that have corrected and then you're buying off the lows. And I don't like to buy them that way. Now, even if the market has been correcting for 5 or 6 weeks, and it turns around, there will be some few stocks that have been going sideways, and they're close to their peak and getting ready to break out. So I don't think you have to wait for them to rally up. I think there will be some that are in that position. But I don't like to buy some stock just because it's down a lot.
Yeah.
And if it's the best stock around, it shouldn't be down too much, and it should be coming back pretty quick.
You know, and there's no doubt, you know, when you look in Investor Business Daily, folks, what Amy Smith, Bill's tigress over at IBD had brought up on Monday, those oil stocks and particularly those ones doing business in the Perma Basa, they've gone sideways. It's amazing. When she had me bringing them up, I'm saying to myself, this is unbelievable that the S&P didn't come down hard, but the Nasdaq did, and these stocks just went sideways. I mean, they didn't even give up a dollar. Amazing.
Well, that's telling you something. Usually, and when a market corrects, the ones that correct the least will be your best stocks, and they come back quicker.
Yes.
So what's happening, it's saying that there's a movement in toward oil stocks.
You know, folks, there's 3 or 4 different questions in here, Bill. And what it is this. You know, what I've heard out here today, what folks have heard is that, listen, folks, you know, buy the earnings, buy the growth, you know, take money at 15%, 13%, cut your losses at 4%, 3%, 4%. Don't let it go. When you do the math on that, folks, you're making money, period. What folks seem to struggle with is they have the expansion on the way up. They know you've made the money, and then they don't get out. And, you know, I got 3 or 4 of them in here. It's like, how, you know, what can make me get out of that stock?
Well, I'll tell you something simple. Just operate like a robot with numbers. In other words, anything that's up 15%, start selling some of it.
Yes.
Anything that's down 5%, start selling some of it. Operate with numbers. I will sell a lot of stocks just because they're up 15 or 20%. No other reason. I want to nail down a worthwhile gain, and I want to cut the losses. And don't sit there with losses saying, oh, well, it's a good company, and it'll come back. Maybe it doesn't, and it just goes lower. So cut the losses short and nail down some of the gains. Once, say if you were taking 5% losses and 15% profits, I don't think that you would get into trouble.
Right. And how do you handle, not you personally, but folks, and you know, and I absolutely agree with you. Sometimes when I look at the market, and I'm not in the market, people say, well, you're in the market. Why are you in the market? I say, well, I'm not in the market because I don't think there's any money to be made in the market right now. How can you relate that to folks that there's nothing wrong with being in cash?
Well, if you're fully invested all the time, sooner or later you're going to get hurt. And when the market corrects, it corrects substantially. And the growth stocks that you should have been in will correct twice as much as the market. So there is a time to be in the market, and there's a time to back out. I don't set my thing saying I should be 100% invested or I should be back to only 50 or something.
Yes.
I just let the selling I'm doing, all of a sudden I may be only 25% in the market because I sold two or three stocks because they were up and needed to be sold.
And, of course, what would end up happening, you're not chasing stocks. You know you're going to get them coming out of a base, right? So that is how you'd be only 25% invested. You're not just going to sell a stock and just say, okay, now I've got to get in another one because it's going higher, right?
Well, that you've got to be careful. If you sell a stock and take a gain, you don't have to spend that money the same day. Wait 3 or 4 days or a week or two and look for some stock that's got its base and got everything there and the right time to buy. But if you sell something to nail down a gain and buy something the same day, well, sooner or later, when the market tops, you're still going to be fully invested because you sold one and turn around and put the money back in something else.
Yeah, totally. No doubt. Well, listen, you know, it's always a pleasure talking with you. I want to thank you for all the listeners out there for a great education. And, you know, if I've heard anything, and it's so great to get this reinforced, Bill, is that, you know, it's talking about earnings, it's talking about growth, it's talking about being a robot, it's talking about taking your profit, cutting your losses, end of story, right?
Yes, bingo. And you have to follow those rules.
Right.
Not go by how you feel or what you think.
That's a beautiful thing. And listen, folks, hit the Investor Business Daily banner at TFNN, and you can be with Bill again April 24th, complimentary of IBD, the 30th anniversary, and Bill's going to be talking about past, present, and future market leaders. Bill O'Neil, congratulations again. Great run. Look forward to another 30 years, man. We'll be out there growling and prowling with you.
Okay, thanks, Mel.
Thanks, man. Have a great one. Have a safe one.
Yeah.
And always remember, folks, whatever you think about, you bring about. Whatever you focus on grows. And whatever you want in life, folks, visualize it like a nice big motion picture. Step into it. Take ownership of it and fly with it. Bill just showed you, folks, okay, everything you need is right inside you. He gives you the keys to the markets. The keys to the markets are what? The keys to the markets are taking it at 15%. Take some money off the table. Take your money off the table when you're down 4.5%. You can be in cash. It's not the end of the world, folks, okay? Do your homework. Put the fundamentals together with the technicals. What ends up happening when you do that, folks? You get rid of the clutter. You're going to get rid of paying attention to what someone else may want to be pushing inside the marketplace, and it's self-empowerment. It's flying like an eagle. It's what the USA is all about, folks. It's what William O'Neill's all about. It's what IBD is all about. It's what Tom O'Brien's all about. It's what TFNN is all about. Have a great one. Have a safe one. And you know what? Have a great weekend, folks. We look forward to speaking to you right back here. Wow! Go get them, folks.
With the launch of Tiger TV, TFNN has brought our programming to the next level. With Tiger TV, you can gain access to each host's charts and computer screens as they host their daily stock program. Whether it's Tom O'Brien, Steve Rhodes, Basil Chapman, David White, Larry Pesavento, Andy Hecht, Victor Jones, or Daryl Martin, you can catch all of our technicians hosting their programs live and archived on Tiger TV for your viewing pleasure 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. If you haven't checked out Tiger TV, then visit TFNN.com and see what you're missing.